Your presence,
Holy Spirit, thank you for your presence. Thank you for being here. Thank you that you'll never leave us and forsake us.
On this morning, as we hear the water flowing, we thank you for your living water flowing within us like a spring in a well. Thank you, God. So come this morning, we pray. Touch our hearts, our minds, our souls, our lives for you. Thank you, God, for what you're going to do in each person in this room. We praise you in the mighty name of Jesus. Would you take a moment and greet those around you, and then you may have a seat.
Hey!
You don't want my illness, so that's the best plan. Or maybe not even. Yeah.
Be seated as you are led. It is good to be in the house of God with the people of God. It's been amazing. Just the relationships that I've seen develop, but also got to participate in and just getting to know you. I've been reflecting on that this week, how blessed it is to be part of this congregation here. Just a couple of things from last week. Thank you for bringing all that awesome food. There's a couple dishes that I want the recipes for, but I don't know who made them, and I won't take up this time to ask. But thank you for bringing all that food. Coming to the congregational meeting, and especially thank you to those who allowed their names to stand for elder and deacon, and for those who were selected out and will be serving the next 3 years. Just so you know, on June 5, we'll have an installation service for those individuals, and their first meeting is the second Monday of, well, every month, but in June, second Monday of the month. And just thank you. It was wonderful to worship with you all last week. So we have something special. This morning we're going to say thank you to the volunteers, but we're going to say thank you to someone who's not a volunteer in this way. This morning, and Donna, I'd like you to come up. I know you don't want to, but John, can you make her get up and come up here? So Donna has been our church custodian for the last, while, and she's done an amazing job, but she, God has really opened up other opportunities, but as she retires from cleaning our church and praying through our church, we want to give her an award, and it's the Golden Duster Award. For doing an amazing job, and I can't even begin to describe how just amazing that was. So this is yours, and thank you so much.
Speech.
I could say something too.
Thank you, Donna. That was you don't have to talk. It's totally fine.
It's made
she
both
did awesome though.
Yeah.
It made the church look awesome. It made my life really easy. So thank you to Donna for that. The other thing we just want to say thank you for, and that we try to do a better job on, and it's always like, oh man, we should do it better next year. We're just like, it just catches up with you. But if you were here last week, you saw Scott Rush made a slide in the presentation at the congregational meeting. And one of the main slide, like just in terms of time, right? Like Mark and I and the other people, a couple people who are on staff here at Calvary, it's like we can't do everything. It's kind of amazing that there's so many people that do so much, and Scott had thrown the number out. It's like 60,000 hours that it takes for like you guys in the pews right now to make just things happen at Calvary, like just anything. Just name it, and there's probably a volunteer behind it. So that's just an incredible amount of time that you spend just blessing Calvary, blessing people who come into our doors here, blessing our community. So thank you so much for doing that, taking time out of your own lives and pouring in so that we can sort of give out too. So thank you so much. I don't know how to just describe every ministry we have. There's so many. It's just unreal. So thank you so much just from on behalf of staff, council. It's huge. So thank you very much. The other thing I have to say this morning is in your mailbox right now. Like, I just pulled mine out of my mailbox. There's a, if you have one, and I'll tell you what to do if you don't have one yet, but if you have one, this is in your mailbox today. This is sort of your listing of what's in our church directory. Hey, how do I get a hold of that guy? I heard of his name. I'd like to call him or something. This is just to make sure it's right. So if you've moved or gotten a new email or something or a new number in the past 6 months since we did our other one, and we know there's a lot of changes, just cross out or change anything that you might see there. Write something in new. And then there's also other information on there that you can check out and select. This, when you're done with it, if you have no changes, just recycle it kindly. If you have a bunch of changes or just one or whatever, there's a thing called an inbox on the information desk in the back. Just slide it in there. Just anything and everything goes in the inbox. So just that's where you put that, or hand it to me. The other thing that we have to say is, just if you don't have a mailbox and you'd like one, just let me know, right? Talk to me, talk to Mark, send me an email, jquist@calvarywy.org, whatever, call me. So we can hook you up with that. If you're a visitor this morning, we're glad you're with us. And if you want to learn more about Calvary, we have opportunities for that, and Mark can talk about that in a second too. But we're glad you're here. And in the pew in front of you, we have these little connection cards. Mm-hmm. And we'd love it if you just filled one of those out sometime, and today even, and just throw it in the offering as it goes by. And we'd love to connect with you more and just figure out how to meet you, how to get to know you. So.
That's awesome. I want you to note that we brought back the original cut and paste on this, by the way. Cut and paste. It was pretty cool. Also, if you're not in the directory, feel free to fill one of these out and put it in. So one of the things we struggle with as people join the church is figuring out how to equip you to be the church. And we experiment. Sometimes our experiments fade off. We don't bring them back. But this is our latest experiment. So there's one of these in your box. And this will be at the church information desk, which is brand new. I didn't even notice, but it's brand new. But the point is, this will always be there. So if you want to put your name on it and say, I'd like to do this. But probably more importantly, even as you meet people who are coming to church for the first time, say, hey, if you'd like to sign up, you can put your name here and figure out where you particularly are called to serve and to be part of the church. So that's at the information desk and in your thing. So I think that's it for all the announcements. We have a kind of a special welcome this morning. We'd like to welcome the new members to Calvary Church. So we're trying to improve our way of doing this, and we had a new members class a while back, and I'd like to invite those of you who are at that class to come forward, and we're just going to welcome and pray for you. So Marilyn Norris, Marilyn Gills, Doug and Sherry Bowson, your awesome kids. Lance, come on up. And let's just go up here and have some of the elders come up right away, or all the elders come up right away, just we want to pray. And Vicky, thank you so much. It's hard to pull names out of my head. Vicky's my neighbor. And Marilyn, even though you've got this radical haircut and I hardly recognize you, it still works. Come on up. So I'll go down here. And we basically don't want to embarrass anybody, but I did offer, is anyone going to share anything? You feel led to share anything? Don't need to. Doug's actually a preacher, so I'm hoping he can share more and more. But I'll just share this. It's been wonderful to get to know each and every one of you. Obviously, it's been different ways. Vicki, I remember you coming to the dinner, and then your face getting more and more of a smile over the months. And Marilyn, I remember seeing you at the coffee spot. Carolyn invited you there, and it's been wonderful to get to know you. Strangely, Marilyn sat down at the new members meeting, and they have a lot in common, right? Both come out of the Baptist church, I got that right? And Marilyn, and just a whole bunch of other stuff, so it's been wonderful. And Lance, it's been really good to know you. So Lance's daughter and my daughter go to school together, and so I kind of saw Lance at the door a few times at parties and whatnot, but it's been wonderful to get to know you. So what we're going to do is we're going to pray, and we're going to pray for y'all as you become part of this church, that we'd be able to serve you, that you'd be able to serve the body of Christ in this place and the community in this place, and that we'd be the church together. And really, this is a symbol of what we're called to do as a church always. So let's go ahead and pray. Father God, I thank you so much for these individuals. I thank you for your spirit. I thank you for how your spirit has brought each one of us here, whether we're just joining the church or whether we've been part of the church for a long time. But your spirit brought us here. And some of us are here kind of to our surprise. We didn't ever think we'd join this type of church, Christian Reformed Church, or a church in Wyoming, or the church at all. Or we didn't expect even to be in this town, but here we are in this place here. And Father, as we've learned over the last years, that except for your spirit, this church is not going to be the kind of church that you want us to be. So I pray that you would help us move forward, that you would guide us, that you give us wisdom. You give each one of these individuals, young or old, the spirit to help them be the church that you've called us to be.
Dear Lord, we thank you so much for the stories of how we came to know you, how we came to grow in you, dear Lord, and we ask that as a church we can participate in that growth. We pray that we can be a learning church, that we can learn from these new members, and they can help grow us.
And we thank you, Lord, that you have directed Calvary to open up our arms to the community and to help to meet the needs that are out there. And as we look at these new members, we are so thankful that they are willing to join our efforts, and they are willing to also just be a part of Calvary and strengthen us as well.
Father, in your mercy, we ask that you equip us all with the Word of God to get to know you better, to walk together as a body. That you give us this imagery of body, and it's so appropriate. Each one of us is different, unique, but we're all called to be part of one body, and I pray that you yourself we do your work in this place as we continue to grow to become more like you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. 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 Thank you. Thank you. So consider yourself welcome and officially part of Calvary. Thank you. So if there's one area that we need to grow in, it is becoming the body organically. Our church used to have a great big ministry for small groups, and we are growing back into it. One of the ways we're growing in terms of figuring out even how to have a new members class. So we were supposed to have a new members class this afternoon. Some of you are planning on it. But I had a little problem. I was planning on doing a new members class, and I was planning on preaching at the evening service. They're not really compatible because I can't be in two places at one time. And a lot of the new members work second shift jobs in the afternoon. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to call everybody who's on the list, and we're going to schedule a time probably in the evening where we can get together. But if you'd like to join the church officially, just write your name down, and I will make some phone calls as soon as possible, and I apologize for that. So we're growing in that. But please do that. Let's have a time of prayer for God to continue to lead us forward. So Jesus, we look to you. We look to you. And this morning, we sing songs to you, and we welcome people into the church. But Father, I just want to take a step back and focus on the cross. And you can even open your eyes and look at the cross as we pray. If not for the cross, Father, we wouldn't be here. If you hadn't led the way through sacrificing yourself on the cross and dying, we would not be alive in you. If you hadn't risen from the dead as our Lord and Savior, we would still be living in all kind of mess. The whole world would be unspeakably messed up. And we wouldn't even begin to be here. So Father, we give you all the glory. We're not here because of the worship team. We're not here because of the building. We're not here because of me. We're not here because of our friends that invited us here. We're here because of you, Lord. And we give you all the glory, honor, and praise this morning. Lord, I pray as a church that everything we do would be focused on you. That by your Spirit, we'd seek you, that we'd seek to be more like you, that we'd seek to live in you. But you talk about how we're supposed to live in you, and have your characteristics, have your perspective, have your life. Father, we need you. We need the power of Jesus in us through your Holy Spirit. We long to be more like you. Lord, we long to have you get involved in our lives and our families. Lord, our kids need us to be more like you. Our parents need us to be more like you. Our brothers and sisters need us to be more like you, whether they're family or whether they're spiritual brothers and sisters. Our neighbors need us to be more like you. Instead of complaining about their loud music or other behavior, they need us to represent you and your power and your love and your mercy, your forgiveness. Jesus, whatever we do here this morning, I pray that it be centered on you, and that even literally or physically or figuratively, probably better said, you're asking us to die as you died to ourselves. And none of us want to be crucified, physically, spiritually. We don't want to die to ourselves. We don't want to put ourselves on the cross. But Lord, we ask this morning that we'd die to whatever we need to die to. And that we would rise again in your power and your life. We remember our baptism, that in our baptism what was symbolized is dying and rising to you, Father. So we give you all the glory. We give you all the praise. We give you all the honor, Lord. Calvary is a church, and we long to be a church that's focused on you and nothing else. And out of that, we long to serve each other. We long to pray for each other. We long to see healings of physically, spiritually, emotionally, freedom from addiction, Lord. We long to see your miraculous power move in this place and in our lives. Father, we give you all the glory. If not for the cross, Lord. If not for the cross. If not for the cross, we wouldn't be here. We wouldn't be alive. In your name we pray these things. Amen. We usually do a time of intercession now, but what I'd like to invite you to do is, there's prayer cards in front of you, and if you have a prayer concern or intercession that you would like prayer for, or if you have some praise, I'd like to invite you to write that down as we take the offering and pray through that, and we'll gather those and pray through them as a church, maybe at the end of church, maybe during the week, but I'd like to invite you to do that as we give our offering. The children can go to children's worship this morning. And I think it might be the last one for the season, right? So you can do that. And our offering is for what's on the screen, which is Calvary Ministries and Ben and Carrie David, who Carrie grew up here, and they are teaching and sharing the gospel in Uganda, if you don't know about that. So we give our offerings, prayer concerns, visitor cards, and a time of worship at this time.
You hear me when I call, you are my morning song. Though darkness fills the night, it cannot hide the light. Whom shall I fear? You crush the enemy underneath my feet. You are my sword and shield. Though troubles linger still, whom shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. My strength is in your name, for you alone can save. You will deliver me. Yours is the victory. Whom shall I fear? Shall I fear? I know who goes before me. I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. No.
shall stand. You hold the whole world in your hands. I'm holding on to your promises. You are faithful. You are faithful. You are faithful. Before me, I know who stands behind. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The one who reigns forever, he is a friend of mine. The God of angel armies is always by my side. The God of angel armies is always by my side.
Almost to the end of our sermon series on James, Death to Selfie. Is anybody still alive? Yes. All right. Death to selfie, so we can live in Christ. So this morning, Sean Wiemhoff is going to read scripture for us from James chapter 5, verses 7 through 12. That's the wrong text there, but James chapter 5, verses 7 through 12. I probably moved it. Here you go.
Microphone.
He's on it. All right.
7 through 12, right?
Yep.
Be patient. Then, brothers, until the Lord's coming. Lord's coming. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its bullable crops, and how patient he is for the autumn and spring rains. You too be patient and stand firm, because the Lord's coming is near. Don't grumble against each other, brothers, or you will be judged. The judge is standing at the door. Brothers, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. As you know, we consider blessed those who have persevered. You have heard of Job's perseverance, and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. The Lord is full of compassion and mercy. Therefore, my brothers, do not swear, not by heaven or by earth or by anything else. Let your yes be yes, and your no no, or you will be condemned. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Thank you, Sean. All right. So, you know what the saying is, in polite company, don't talk about two things. What are they? Why do I ask rhetorical questions on Sunday morning? All right. What are the other two things? Religion and politics. Thank you. Thank you. You know, sometimes you think I should just quit, right? Religion and politics. This morning we're going to talk about both, and we're not going to talk about those. We'll save those for another Sunday completely. Well, I guess we hit money last week. So, religion and politics. We often talk about religion on Sunday morning. That's sort of the point. But today we're going to hit politics. And just in case you start going, getting angry when I'm talking about politics, I'm going to talk about politics so that we get into the scripture better. That might be the point. I just don't want anybody to walk out and slam the door. So, this morning, we're going to start at the park. because I was there yesterday morning working on the sermon. This is Johnson Park over on Butterworth Drive or somewhere out there across the river. Beautiful sunny morning. And I was sitting there in the park just reflecting on wonderful summer that's finally come to Michigan here. And there's people at the park enjoying all sorts of things. There's a run and there's people in blue shirts getting ready for that run. There was an older lady who came by on her bike with really beautiful gray hair, and it's obvious she spent a lot of time on her bike because she had all the clothes, she was fit, she's getting ready to go on a long ride. There was a 30-something-year-old couple that had a little bit of extra weight on, and they had their little watches, and they had their little doodads, and they're just starting getting running, trying to get into shape. It was really wonderful to see them have a great time doing that. And then as I looked around behind me, a motorcycle drove in, and eventually I looked back, and this is right when I was getting in the car, and they were doing something kind of strange. I don't know if you can see this, but the guy that drove in on a motorbike eventually put some lime green sunglasses on, and then he put a tutu on. See that? You got to be kind of secure to do that, I'm thinking, right? But I snapped a picture of him. I didn't want him to come over and do something, so I just snapped a picture of him and ducked into the van because I thought it was kind of cool. They were doing some fun run, and they were dressing up, and I don't know what was going on, but he definitely was secure about himself. But it highlighted to me, even though there's beautiful weather, even though it's a beautiful park, and people all doing all sorts of American, really human, but American things, hanging out of the park on a Saturday morning, this sort of brought out how people in America are doing some things that are kind of weird, strange, and honestly, as people who are following Jesus, we would wish that they weren't doing those things, and that's been sort of a theme in America, right? Maybe America isn't as Christian as it once was, and we talk about this, and obviously this guy is just having fun, but there are people in America not at the park Saturday morning doing other things that we wish they wouldn't do, and as a culture, we're sort of drifting that way, perhaps. So I'll just leave that there and come back to it. The other thing that I think really was highlighted by my trip to the park was not everybody can come to the park on a Saturday morning. Not everybody gets to enjoy hanging out at the park. Not everybody gets to enjoy life. There's a lot of poverty in America. There's a lot of discrimination in America. Some people, it's not even safe to go to certain parks because of their skin color and background. It's just the truth that everything is not right in America. Even if you go to a park or some other places in the States here, and it would seem like everything's beautiful. There are things that are messed up about our culture. Poverty, sin, it's not all good. So what is the response that we're called to have to this type of situation? Well, here in the States, people sort of look at other things to provide the answers. One of our default things is to look to Capitol Hill. And so if you would think about what we would blame in America for the issues that we currently have, most of us, don't blame Trump yet, but most of us look at the federal government. Many of us look at the federal government. See, if the federal government would have done things different, things would be different. In the last couple of years, 4 or 5 years, 8 actually, that a lot of that guilt, a lot of that frustration has been put on someone named Barack Obama, right? So, people aren't necessarily happy with our president. And I have friends that put on Facebook, Obama this, Obama that, and none of them are very positive. We have Obamacare, and that gets run down. We have Obama phones, even though George Bush actually put that bill and I guess got it signed or whatever. It'd be kind of weird to have a Bush phone, wouldn't it? I don't know what that would be. But anyway, the Obama phones. And so now all this anxiety is getting transferred on our presidential hopefuls, I guess, at this point. So we got Donald Trump, and I tried to find good pictures, and so many pictures, Donald Trump, honestly, he's sitting there going like this, you're like trying to look presidential or something. I'm not really sure what he's doing. But this, he's actually having fun, and he's like going, nah, he's probably mocking somebody. And it kind of highlights to me, he is, he's like, I'm a nice guy, I'm a nice guy. And we all expected him to choke, and he's not choking. What would Donald Trump bring to the United States? I'm not really sure, but it would be awesome. It would be very, very awesome, right? It'd also be very, very vague. Don't really know what he's going to do. It'd be very, very vague. But it's going to be awesome. It's going to be great. And it's going to be beautiful. And not too many specifics, but lots of generalities. So that's one potential solution to our problems here in America. The other one is this. And I had to look. I found this picture, and I kind of like it, actually. And It sort of highlights Hillary in her, one of her better moments. You know, she's not railing against somebody. A lot of pictures on the internet of Hillary being angry, by the way, right? She gives these speeches and they freeze the frame when she's most angry and like, oh, Hillary. Anyway, you know, I honestly think sometimes when I look at Hillary, maybe I wouldn't react so negatively to her if she was a man. I'm just wondering about that sometimes because she's pretty strident. Maybe something in me is reacting against that. I think if she just went as somebody's mom or grandma, we'd all go, oh, that's just a wonderful lady who's trying to be president. But a lot of us react pretty negatively to Hillary. What is she going to do as president? She'll probably continue the moderately liberal agenda that she's known for, and hopefully she won't do anything too crazy. In the middle, there's, In the middle, there's Bernie Sanders. And I like Bernie Sanders because of his hairline, right? He's got a great hairline, and he doesn't comb his hair, and I kind of respect that about him. He's just like, whatever, I'm here. I'm not here to look pretty. I'm here to get the job done. Now, you know, honestly, Bernie Sanders might mess up our national debt even more than it's messed up. It might go from trillions to, I don't know, whatever the next number is. What is the next number after trillion? Well, our grandkids will know what that number is because of the national debt. But in any case, you know, his basic philosophy is take from the rich, give to the poor. And I don't know what that would do to our country, but I do like the idea of having a Little John, Robin Hood's assistant, as vice president. I think that'd be cool, Little John for vice president. So one of these people is going to become president of our country unless something very unforeseen happens. And I don't know that any of us are super thrilled about either one of them. Now, why do I bring all this up? I bring all this up because as I've been talking, I'm hoping that you've been reacting against something I've said positive about one of these three individuals. And I'm hoping you're going in the background thinking, well, this is who I think should be president. This is who I think should be president. Or maybe you're agreeing with me and going, man, this is such a mess. I have no idea what we're going to do, but something's messed up here in America when we got these three choices. Or maybe you're mad at me for saying that. But we just get, I bring this up to illustrate that we get really, really involved in federal politics, and we all got a lot of opinions about what would be best for our country, what would be worse for our country. We're really invested in this process, and we think, well, we should be invested in this process. But here's the point. Our scripture this morning goes in a very, 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 very different direction. It says, be patient, then, until the Lord's coming. This text is in the context of rich, and wealthy people who have all the control. All of it. And they don't, the people he's writing to, have any power at all. And James doesn't go to them saying you should be more invested in politics, you should do this, you should do that, you should be anxious about the Roman policies, the Roman centurions that are put in charge of you, Pontius Pilate or wherever his successor was. He didn't say any of that. He says basically in the context of rich and wealthy people that have all the power, what we're called to do is to be patient until the Lord's coming. That's a very different emphasis than the emphasis many of us grew up in, which is kind of emphasized, comes out of the Kuyperian tradition, which is transforming culture. It's a very different emphasis. It says, be patient until the Lord is coming. It's in the context of rich people, and I want to talk about rich people here in America just a little bit. All right, so here's the video that was done a few years ago, and the general idea is here. Let me grab my little pointy thing. The general idea is here that this is the wealth distribution that many people think would be ideal. So basically, some people don't have that much money, the middle class here, and some people, because of their business acumen or because of their wisdom, they just get wealthy. But maybe 3 or 4 times as wealthy as the people around them. By the way, this is pretty biblical. When Israel was called to live in the new land, they were burning prohibited to live in the old land. And so they had to live prohibitions against selling and buying land so that everybody would eventually live in the same type of environment. It wouldn't be really wealthy and really poor. That shifted, by the way, when the kings came into power. Archaeologically, they know this, that people got bigger and better houses. It shifted when the kings came into power. But when they were sort of a theocracy under God, it was very level. So this is seen as ideal. This is what, at least we used to think, was the actual wealth distribution here in America. It was here, and then
they are wealthy, but you know, they're just more wealthy. They have slightly bigger houses, slightly bigger 401ks. This is what we generally think. The wealthy are really quite wealthy, but they're still within reach. In this video, it goes on and talks about what the actual wealth distribution is. And this is the actual wealth distribution here in America. So let me just break this down. Somebody's seen this before. So the top 90% are basically, they own all that. And we are somewhere down here. So they have maybe 10, 12, 14 times. This is like standing next to the Sears Tower in Chicago, whatever it's called now, and going, I'm this wealthy, they're that wealthy. There's a huge difference here in America. And then it gets worse because the 1%, as we talked about, and I suppose you can talk about this differently, argue about this differently, but this illustrates the point sort of true. The 1% here in America, the top 1%, own this much wealth. So 1% own that much wealth. It just goes with, this is like a tower that goes to the International Space Station. There's vast amounts of wealth in 1% of the population. This is growing and growing and growing. All right, so this week, my daughter asked me about what Ivy League schools are. I did a little bit of research. I knew what schools out east. I thought Harvard and Yale were part of it. But these are the symbols of Ivy League schools. Anyone know the Ivy League schools? What are some of them?
Ivy, Dartmouth, Princeton.
Awesome. Awesome. Anyone go to any of them? Anybody? Anybody go to Harvard? I love saying Harvard. You go to Yale, Brown, no one went. All right, so the point is here, is there are schools out east, these and others, that are for the upper class people. People who own a lot of resources, and not everybody that goes there is wealthy and all that. But the point is, there's a whole culture in America here that's vastly wealthy. They send their kids to the boarding school when they're second and third grade so that they meet people that they can do business with the rest of their life so they can be part of this upper class thing. And last week I was talking about sort of the dangers of being rich. This week, that's not my point. My point this week is we will never be part of that world. Ever. It's not going to happen. It might happen if God allows you somehow by His provision to become incredibly wealthy and to be part of the rich and powerful. But you, none of us here will ever be part of that 1%, that really, really rich and powerful element here in America that really functionally controls a lot of the things that happen here in America. Now that's sort of distressing because I think I have a vote. I'm an American. I should be able to influence the politics. And yes, you have a vote. But honestly, it doesn't matter how much we complain, talk about it, think about it, have all the great wisdom in our head. Most of us, except for one vote,
every 2 years aren't going to do much to influence the national scene here in America. And we get back to the text. What does the text say? Does it say be really concerned and go vote every 4 years? No, you can't vote in the Roman Empire anyway. It says be patient then until the Lord's coming. That's the point this morning. Be patient until the Lord's coming. And then it has some very helpful analogies. It says this. See how the farmer waits for the land to yield its valuable crop. All right, see this? Instead of looking at rich people, instead of looking at the powerful, it says, look at the farmer. The guy who has his hands dirty and has a bunch of implements and tools and goes around sowing seeds. Says, you want to know how to live? Look at the farmer. Look at the farmer who sows his crop. That's what you're supposed to do. That valuable crop. Don't look at the rich people. Don't look at the powerful people. Look at the farmer. What's the application? You too be patient and stand firm because the Lord's coming is near. Now, honestly, when I look at the political situation, I'm a little bit anxious. I'm a little bit wondering what to do. And people keep talking about, I'm going to move to Canada, and I'm going to move to Canada. Marcia and I actually have citizenship in Canada. We could move tomorrow, so we actually could do that. And Justin Trudeau, the Prime Minister of Canada, is awesome, by the way. But we're not going to do that functionally. What are we supposed to do? Look at the problems? Look at the farmer. Go find a farmer and look at him. Just like stare at him. You'd be like, what are you doing? I'm looking at the farmer. Don't do that. But think about it. Find a YouTube video or something. All right, the next one is, brothers, that is, as an example of patience in the face of suffering, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. This is the next thing. Look at the Old Testament prophets. Now, I know it's hard reading through Isaiah and Jeremiah, and then you get to Ezekiel, and you think, what on earth is this guy running around naked for? Like, all right, now you're going to read the Bible. All right, what is he doing? Like, what is, it's long passages and like, what is going, but here, look at the prophets who, as an example, in the face of suffering, were patient. These guys lived in incredibly difficult times. Reading through the book of Jeremiah and the passages right now and the scripture readings plan that's at the sermon resource table, just read through Jeremiah. And it's incredible what this guy went through, and eventually he ends up in Egypt in exile. I love the passage about his servant. His servant is complaining how it's so hard, and basically there's this passage that says to him, hey, look, you're not going to get everything in the world, but you're not dead. Be happy. It's like, really? They actually found this guy's ring, Jeremiah's servant's signet ring. They found it via archaeology, and it has his name on it. So I don't know how it got buried and we found it eventually. But a real guy living, and God's like, just live. Stop whining. So as an example, again, be patient. In the face of powerlessness, be patient in the face of suffering. What's the application? We know we consider blessed those who have persevered. That's why we watch movies, right? We watch movies because people get through difficult things, go through awesome things. We love it. 2.5 hours, victory, it's awesome. But real life, we consider blessed those who have persevered through difficulty. We respect those people. All right, moving on. You've heard of Job's perseverance and have seen what the Lord finally brought about. Job had everything, had it all stripped away, and then God brought him into a whole new experience. Mark Spangler, who has to work on Sundays right now and is processing that with God, but anyway, became a Christian about a month and a half ago. I was talking to him the other day. So he became a Christian when he was homeless. And then he got bed bugs in the motel. The church helped him pay for it. And he's sitting there going through this. He's got sores all over his body. His family don't want him very much. And he's just like a mess. He's looking at the book of Job going, man, if I ever found myself in the text, I found myself here. And just really going through it. A couple weeks later, the sores are gone. He dealt with the bed bugs, threw all his clothes away, basically, and sort of washed and got some new ones down in the image. And he has got a smile on his face. God gave him 2 jobs. He's got a relationship with Jesus. And you look at him and you realize that the Lord really is full of compassion and mercy. The difficult thing is when you're going through a difficult time, you have sores in your body, everything's messed up, you think, is God really full of compassion and mercy? And the answer is yes. Yes. But it takes time. All right, so 2 cautions in this, and I'm going to get to an interview. 2 cautions. These texts in James are like many texts that I memorized out of context, meaning I knew about them, but I didn't really know about the context. And I really struggled with this week. Like, what? Why is this here? So in this context of being patient in the midst of rich people who have all the power and us having none of the power and we're suffering because we're economically marginalized, etc., etc., it says this, don't grumble against each other, brothers. Don't grumble against each other. Why does it say that here? Well, it turns out when people are oppressed, often they take their frustration out on each other. It turns out when the middle class has no real influence in the broader culture, we take our complaints to Facebook and Twitter and in conversation. And we grumble about who's in power, who isn't in power, about what the people in power should do. I mean, we just grumble and grumble and grumble. A few weeks ago I talked about slandering, and it really convicted me for a couple weeks. I gotta keep my mouth shut sometimes. And then the last couple weeks I noticed things come out a little bit faster than they should, and here it is again. Don't grumble. And you think, well, I'm not allowed to grumble about politics. I didn't say it, all right? Jesus said it. James said it. Yeah, James said it. I didn't say it. The Bible says it. Don't grumble against each other, or you'll be judged. And then the other one is this. Above all, my brothers, do not swear, not by heaven, or by earth, or by anything else. Sometimes the frustrations in our culture will tend to make us go in this direction and say things that we never really should be saying at all. The problem is once we get under oppression affects our minds, it affects our personalities, and we end up saying things that we should not end up saying. And what James is coming back to again, he's saying, what about your character? What about your character? Just because Obama is president, just because Trump might be president, or Hillary, a really, really long shot, Bernie Sanders, just because they're president doesn't mean you get to get frustrated and angry and talk about all kinds of stuff. Don't do it. Don't do it. And finally, there's this. I finally figured out what he was talking about this morning on this. He says, the judge is standing at the door. There's condemnation here in this passage. He says, let your yes be yes, no, no, or you'll be condemned. What is that about? Just going to put this out here because it's in the text. When we do these things, what we do is we separate ourselves from God. When our character goes downhill, when we complain, when we lament, instead of being patient, instead of seeking God, our character goes downhill, and by sinning, we separate ourselves from God. And if we go down that long enough, we become grumpy and angry, men and women, or children, or old people, and we separate ourselves from God, and God's over there, we're over here, blah, 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 we know everything, everything's messed up, and eventually, God's over there, we're here, and we get condemned, because we're not living the way we're called to live. The whole text is an invitation in the midst of powerlessness, in the midst of a situation where we have no control, to say, you know what? I'm going to follow Jesus. I'm going to be who he has called me to be. So as I thought about this this whole teaching, which really is kind of against some of the things I've been taught, ultimately I think it complements it, I remembered some conversations I had with Mike Gulker, who is a pastor in the Mennonite tradition and a member of our church by associate membership, and his wife also was just selected to be a deacon here at Calvary Church. So they're part of this church, they're part of a Mennonite fellowship down in Kalamazoo, and they needed to be down there this morning, so I interviewed him and have it done in a kind of a way I haven't done before. So we'll see how this works. We have him via TV. I'll let that get started. These things are now set to go off automatically. All right, so you know, it always takes a while for people to come out front here. We'll just see how long this takes. Okay, here we go. So I will pause that. And then I need the mic. Where did I put the mic? All right, does anybody, oh, here it is. All right, so, let me just back up a little bit. All right, so Mike, one thing I want to ask is how you became a Mennonite pastor, having grown up in the Christian Reformed Church.
And had largely a relatively good experience. But as I was in college and working out in the business world, I had a sense that one of the major paradigms of the Christian Reformed tradition, this notion that Christ is going to transform culture, that by going to church and becoming Christian people, then when we weren't in church, we would go out and transform culture. I didn't have a sense that that was actually what was happening. I had a sense that the culture was... us being out in the culture, trying to transform the culture, was actually transforming us to mimic the culture rather than Christ. So I had this sense that something was off. And while I was having that sense, I started reading and following a line of thinking from some scholars that had been heavily influenced by the Mennonites. And they took up this theme from both the Old Testament and that Peter picks up of resident aliens, that we're to treat certain people, those outsiders, really well. We're to do hospitality because we ourselves are resident aliens. We ourselves at one point were and are, really. And as long as we're waiting for Jesus to come again, we are resident aliens wherever we live. And that struck a chord. It was very different than the idea of making this culture look like the kingdom of heaven. It was more like we're called to be a peculiar people in the meantime. And I ended up studying at a university or a divinity school where this stream of thinking was heavily part of the curriculum. And it just deeply, deeply appealed to me, the idea that Christians ought to look different. They ought to be different. They ought to be marked by a certain set of practices and behaviors that looked different than the world. And of course, Mennonites have done this. Now, the Mennonites I was a part of, they weren't driving buggies, they weren't wearing bonnets. Mennonites are, there are lots of different kinds of Mennonites. But I ended up doing an internship at, I never intended to do an internship with a Mennonite church, but my internship at the Presbyterian church I was attending, closest thing to a CRC church around, that fell through, and I ended up at this Mennonite church. And when I went out there, I just had this deep resonance again with, they were looking to be a peculiar people, that their life together was unique and beautiful and attractive and different from the world. And again, those differences weren't bonnets and buggies, but they were the way they shared lives together, the way that they did hospitality, the way that they cared for their neighbors and so on. That was deeply attractive. And so my internship turned into an invitation to serve, and I ended up serving and being ordained in that congregation as a Mennonite.
So thanks for sharing that, Mike. As the church here, we have this sort of thing where we think we should be involved in transforming culture, and that's a good biblical theme, but then we often sort of get stuck on exactly how to do that. So the Mennonite tradition has a very different answer to how to influence culture, really how to respond to a culture that's not Christian around it. I wonder if you could share a little bit about what that tradition is and what that looks like. He's thinking about it.
So traditionally, Mennonites have been looked at as sectarian, or a group that pulls away from culture and being different and therefore abandons culture, whereas Reformed have been very engaged in culture and wanting to be cultural influencers. I don't think they're as different as we might make them. Mennonites very much want to have an impact on culture. However, they think the way to have an impact on culture is to be a very peculiar people, to be a people who make the Sermon on the Mount their politics, as opposed to the politics of the United States or wherever you might be from. That your politics, the decisions, the way you live your life, the rules for your life, the way you treat strangers, the way you treat your enemies, that's given to you by Jesus. And Jesus said, live this way, do these things. And that when we do that, while we don't take ownership for the wider culture, God promises that when we live that way, He will act in powerful ways. And this is very much based on the life of Jesus. I mean, Jesus had all of this power to do miracles and so on and so forth. But He didn't decide that it was His job to heal everybody. It was His job to be obedient to the Father and to proclaim the kingdom of God, even though that led to His death. Nobody knew what He was doing. Even His own disciples are completely confused by this. He's throwing away all of His power and authority in this craziness when He could have had a huge cultural impact. He had a lot of political options in His day. He could have followed the Zealots. They had a political plan. He could have followed the Pharisees. They had a political plan. He could have followed the Sadducees. They had a political plan. There are all these different political options, and He says no to them all and says, look, I do the will of my Father even if it costs me my life. In that, He's vindicated, right? He is raised from the dead by the Father and says, that is the life that matters. This is the life that makes a difference, and I'm going to give you my Spirit too. And so by following Jesus, by being odd, by laying down the tools of the government or the empire and instead following the will of the Father, that's how God acts. This is very much the story of Israel as well throughout the Old Testament. You see Israel, when Israel follows God's direction, however counterintuitive they may seem, God acts in powerful ways. When they turn away from that, they're absorbed by the nations. I think that's the danger for Christians today, is to be absorbed by the different political options on our doorstep. You can be Republican, you can be Democrat, and so on and so forth. Those are your options. That's how you influence the cultures, by being one or the other. And we've forgotten the politics of Jesus, this very basic, I'm going to lay down my life, not only for my friend, but for my enemy. I'm going to turn the other cheek. All of these things that would seem to call into question all of our securities and all of the modes of being effective in our world, and instead leave it up to God to make an impact. And I think the Mennonites have a pretty good argument because Jesus has had a pretty big impact.
So the Reformed tradition and the Mennonite tradition don't exactly have the best church history, something about canons of Dort and Anabaptists and all that stuff. But at this point, when we realize that we're serving one Lord and seeking understanding together, what, if anything, do you think the Reformed church might be able to learn from the Mennonite tradition at this time?
Well, interestingly enough, the rhetoric of the Reformed tradition has become far more Mennonite in the past decade. When I was at Calvin as an undergrad, fascinated with Mennonites, I quoted a Mennonite in class, and I was told by my professor, who is a friend and still is, he said, if you quote that sectarian Anabaptist again in my classroom, I will fail you. And he was serious. So there was a strong resistance, but over the past 10, 20 years, our culture has changed dramatically from what was widely understood as a Christian nation, whether it was or not. It was understood, or maybe a more accurate description would be, folks in power had to defer to a Judeo-Christian history, to the fact that God mattered, that Christianity mattered. If you wanted to be a candidate for president, you probably had to be a Christian. You couldn't have certain moral flaws, or at least not flaunt them publicly. That day is gone. We live now in an age, in a increasingly post-Christian culture, if it ever was Christian, but increasingly secular culture. Mennonites know how to live as a peculiar people. They know how to live in the midst of a society that isn't following Jesus, because they've never thought a national government is going to follow Jesus. They've always thought that, you know, governments are necessary, but they're a necessary evil. We're not to really be all that invested in them. Now, there are all kinds of leaders in the Reformed tradition and within the broader Christian tradition, broader Christian community in the United States, saying very Mennonite things, like, we're going to have to be a peculiar people. We're going to have to be a minority. We're resident aliens in this land. We're not in control. And so I think there are a lot of possibilities for cross-learning. And in fact, last year at Senate, one of the new seminary hires was quoting people I studied with, and which is very unusual to hear those people quoted from the floor of Senate. So I think there's a strong sense of which we are a minority now, and we're going to have to live in as a minority. And being minorities means you don't have the option of exercising power. What you have is the power of the gospel, the power of hospitality, and the power of laying down your life for those that you come across. And that's a very different power.
So the point this morning is not whether we're Mennonite or Reformed or Baptist or Wesleyan. The point this morning is, what does this text say to us? This text says to us that in the face of powerlessness, we're not called to find our identity in ranting and railing against the government. We're called to find our identity in Jesus Christ. We're called to live like he lived, be who he called us to be, and in so doing, we will have a vastly more effective witness to our culture than trying to control things that we're never going to get to control anyway. Now, if God brings you into that, praise God. But on the ground, with our families, with our husbands, wives, friends, neighbors, co-workers, James is calling us to be patient then until the Lord's coming, to develop our character so the people who look at us go, there's something about that person that makes me want to follow Jesus and find out more. So we have this fountain here, and there was a bunch of rocks in it that had all kinds of cool things written on. And as is the point, people took those home, so we got a bit of a fresh batch. And the point this morning is, as we come to worship, as we read the Bible, as we pray with our families, we're called to get a new identity in Jesus Christ. And some of these rocks talk about forgiven. Some talk about hope. Some talk about purity. Some just have a symbol of a heart on them, representing God's love for us. Some talk about trust. Some talk about prayer. I don't know if I said this already. Purity, courage. And what God does, when we come to him and seek him, and seek his strength, is he gives us a new identity. In the power of the cross, in the power of the Holy Spirit, to help us be people that we never could have been, never could have been otherwise. So I want to invite you into a time of prayer. And after the time of prayer, we're going to a time of worship. And I want you to do some business with God as you've been called to do that, to seek your identity from him. Or maybe just to intercede to him for something that's on your heart. And I know often when I invite people up front, you don't have to come, but if you feel led, if you feel that prompting, if you feel that push, please do. Because God might want to do something in your heart that he might not be able to do when you're sitting where you're at right now. Not that God's Spirit can't move anyway, but anywhere, but God sometimes wants to call us forward to do something as a marker in our life. So let me pray and the worship team can come up and let's do some business with God. So Lord Jesus Christ, your mercy spills over into our lives. And this morning, I've talked a lot about how we're not called necessarily to get anxious or get frustrated or get angry in the face of national things that drive us crazy. But Lord, you called us to give us an identity in who you are. That we are people of the book. We are people of Jesus Christ. And we may be part of some party, Republican or Democrat or something else, but Lord, you say our primary identity is called to be in you. That our primary identity is to be part of the kingdom of God. And Father, I give my life to you again. I set aside my personal national agenda and desires, hopes, anxieties. I renounce that, Lord. And I confess that you are true God, King of heaven and earth. And no one comes to power except by your permissive will. There is nothing that happens in this world that you don't allow to happen. Lord, it may look awful, it may be awful from our perspective, Lord, but you allow all things to happen. And no one can rule without your permission. So, Father, we pray that you be with your church at this time and teach us. Teach us whatever you want us to learn. And more than anything, Father, I pray that you'd help us be faithful in this place, in this city, in our area here in Kent County. That you'd help us to be the people of God, standing up as a witness what you've called us to be. So we give our lives to you. We give our heart to you. And as we pray, I invite you to do whatever God's Spirit is leading you to do in prayer. Let's sing this next song, Jim. You can stand.
Is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus. Christ alone. Weak made strong, the Savior's love. Through the storm, he is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide his face, rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds still. My anchor holds still in the bay. Christ alone, cornerstone. Strong.
Patient then until the Lord's coming, for you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, so that you can declare the praises of Him who brought you out of the darkness into the glorious light, the freedom of the children of God. May you be filled with the power of the Spirit. May you know Jesus. May you experience the love of God our Father. Amen.